Good morning, saints of God.
Good morning.
And welcome to the second Sunday of Advent. As you can see, the beautiful tree here in the sanctuary, which represents everlasting life. The evergreen represents everlasting life. Lights represent the fact that Jesus is the light of the world. And thank you, Randy, for the crown. The crown is that he is Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And in keeping with the season, our call to worship points to the mystery of godliness found in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. Without any doubt, the mystery of our religion is great. He was revealed in flesh, vindicated in spirit, seen by angels, proclaimed among Gentiles, believed in throughout the world, taken up in glory.
Good morning. Procedures for masking and safe distancing, so we may all remain safe. Advent is a time of waiting, waiting to celebrate the birth of Jesus. I think we are all waiting when our fellowship will conclude shaking somebody's hands and having a conversation without yelling. When that would be, I think it's best described by what a lady told me when we were speaking with folks during the survey. And when I asked her, when do you think it would be safe to come back to church? And she said, without hesitation, God only knows. And I think she could have added, and he's not telling. So, for us, all we can do is wait. Let us begin the worship with an Advent prayer. The second Sunday of Advent gives us the opportunity to prepare our hearts in faithful waiting to celebrate the birth of Jesus. This week, we pause to remember who God is and what he has done for us. When our lives are so hurried, we only have time to focus on our to-do list, making space in our schedules for prayer and meditation helps us to better see God at work in our lives and in our world. May God's Spirit transform the days leading up to Christmas into a time of holy anticipation, preparing our hearts as we faithfully await the chance to celebrate the arrival of our King.
I just wanted to come before you this morning to announce that Community Outreach is excited once again to participate in giving a Merry Christmas to children in our community. This year, we are focusing on the siblings of Interfaith, not the students that go to the preschool. Interfaith is going to provide through money donations, their gifts. But Anne there informed me that many of the parents there are out of work because of COVID. And the children are really worried about their brothers and sisters. You know, will they get anything? So what we are asking is if this morning you will choose, out in the narthex, there is a angel tree. And you're going to see tags like this, or like this. And they will have, all they are going to say is a boy or a girl, and it will give the age. And the reasons we're doing this is because of the COVID. What we're asking that you would get one or two. There's 35 names left, and I know that's a big number for us, but I believe in our congregation for its giving spirit and wanting to help others in our community. You can, some of the things Ann suggested were toys for the younger ones. Clothing, the only thing about clothing is a lot of the parents are nervous about COVID. So if you wanted to get like hat or gloves or scarf, make sure it's packaged already. That way they've not been tried on or handled. So yes, that for the older ones, she suggested a gift card, books. Someone this morning was asking about food. And it has to be prepackaged. It cannot be handmade from scratch. So if you could do those, and I know this is going to be really short notice, and I apologize for that. If you could have it here at the church by Sunday, or in the church office by Monday, we ask that you have them already wrapped and just attach the gift card, the little tag that you chose, on there so they can help identify them. They know who they'll go with. They're at Interfaith. Let's see. I was just double checking. I just want to, once again, the Community Outreach Committee, to thank you for your help and ask that we help make this a joyful season for the children that are in our community. Thank you.
One more. Wait.
Sure.
Yes, sir.
This means a chance to switch my names.
We kind of snuck this in on Reverend Ellis here. I don't think he knew we were going to do this. I'd just like to say it's good to see a lot of the people we work with, going to church with, that's back here today. Appreciate y'all coming, and it's good really seeing y'all. Worship committee has asked me to make this announcement concerning the Christmas Eve service for this year. With the approval of the elders, two Christmas Eve services are scheduled for 6 p.m. and 7:30 p.m. Each service will last approximately 45 minutes. To comply with Mr. COVID the guidelines are currently in place, and since the service historically has higher attendance, it is necessary that you call Barbara at, or email Barbara at the church office at 783-1139, or email her at barbara@fccdoc.org. If you and our other family members plan to attend, please provide the number in your family attending and which service you prefer to attend, as there will be limited number of seats available for each service, and seats will be filled as reservations are received. If the total number of seats reserved exceeds the number of seats available for either service, it may be necessary to move some reservations to the alternate service. Please, please respond by Thursday, December the 17th, to reserve the number of seats. Thank you.
Thank you.
Your turn.
Thank you, Carl, Connie, and John, and you saved me from having to say that. Had on my list, but you were more thorough than I was going to be. So thank you so, so much. This is a very giving church congregation, so please take to heart everything that's been said so far, including the angel tree, and also the Christmas Eve service, which I understand is one of the largest services that this church has every year. So please make preparation for that. Are there any birthday celebrations this week? Anyone have a birthday this week or wedding anniversary? Okay. So what are we celebrating?
74.
All right, so that's that would be a birthday, right? Hey, congratulations. Would I be fibbing if I said you didn't look a day over 44? Yeah. It's all between the years. Thank you so much, and please, this is no time for us to let up off of COVID precautions. I know that you had already heard when Carl came up, but all of us know this is not getting any better. If anything, it's getting worse, and we don't want to take for granted the fact that, you know, we just don't want to assume that it can't happen here. So please let us be mindful of spacing while we are here on the church property, coming in, going out, and all the time that we are in here. Let's keep social distancing. Done a great job. Our elders and our leaders have done a super job up to this point, and we want to continue to do that. And again, there's a church meeting immediately following our worship service this morning. The report of the pulpit committee, and calling upon you to be here for a few minutes after the worship service today. We also want you to pray for the family of Shirley White. Shirley White passed, and the funeral service was Thursday, December the 3rd at Edwards Funeral Home. Many of you knew her from being a member here at this church. So please keep that family in prayer. Those are the concerns that we know about. There may be others, but those are the ones that have come to us. So let's pray this morning. Lord God, creator of the ends of the earth, we humbly bow before your divine presence. As we enter into this sacred worship facility to worship you this morning, as we approach the final lap of this unusual year, we thank you for allowing us to come this far by faith. Even though this has been one of the most challenging years that most of us have ever experienced, what we thought would be better by now, has gotten even worse. As we witness continued loss of life, we pray for the scientists who labor to discover a vaccine that will help put an end to this horrific pandemic. May it be safe and may it be effective. Bless the members of this congregation, those who are ill or recovering from health issues, and those who have lost loved ones, including the family of Shirley White. Bless the congregation meeting today, and may your will be done as we prepare for and pray for the person you have chosen to lead this amazing congregation. For we do believe that the best is yet to come. And Lord, please bless America. And let it be more than just words when we declare, in God we trust. And as we come to pray, as you taught your disciples to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Time to watch. This morning we light two candles. The first candle reminds us that Advent is a time for preparation. The second candle reminds us that Advent is also a time of watching. We watch with expectant eyes, trusting that God is active, present, and constantly at work, leading all of our creation toward the plan of redemption. As we light the second candle, we ask for faith to watch for God's presence and open eyes to see all that God is doing. We watch for hope in the midst of despair. We watch for forgiveness in the midst of rebellion. We watch for peace in the midst of conflict. We watch for the presence of God in the midst of a fallen world, and we watch in hope for the Lord. O come, Emmanuel.
Thank you.
sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the
Lord God, one more time, prop me up, fill me and anoint me with your Spirit, and allow me to speak your eternal truth, Word of God, with power. May someone be helped today. May someone's mind be illuminated with the Word of God. So bless now, in the name of Jesus Christ, we do ask, we pray this prayer. Amen. And the angel said, "For nothing will be impossible with God." The reason for that, beloved, is because we serve God of the impossible. There are many, many, many lessons we learn about the strange and mysterious ways of God when we read and study the Christmas story. The most obvious lesson we learn about God through Christmas is that God loves us and God cares about us. Christmas is God going out of his way, come all the way from heaven to this sinful earth as one of us to save us from our sins, the penalty of our sins, and from going to hell when we die. He came disguised as an innocent baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Christmas says to us that God, our Heavenly Father, cares about us. He loves us. Whether we are the least, the last, or even the lost. Then the next lesson that stands out about God and Christmas, at least for me, is that the God of the universe specializes in making possible that which is impossible. Our text declares that nothing is impossible with God. So Christmas is about the possibility of impossibilities being made a reality, and we call these impossibilities miracles. You just heard that beautiful, beautiful rendition. God is in the miracle working business. No one else but God can perform a miracle. Because God loves us and cares about us, he wants us to know that in the midst of our trials, and we are in a trial right now, in the midst of our tribulations, in the midst of our pain, our suffering and sorrow, when there seems to be no way out, he can make a way out of no way. I once heard a preacher say, well, it's not a way out of no way, a way where there seems to be no way. It's because he is a God of miracles, and nothing is impossible with him. God wants us to know that when our backs are against the wall, whether physically, mentally, spiritually, or even financially, he's got our backs and can do the impossible. When all the odds are stacked up against us, and the enemy comes in on us like a flood, God would have us to know that because he is for us, nothing is too hard for him. He is in the miracle business, so God gave us Christmas. God gave us his son Jesus, because there are times when nothing less than a miracle will do. Christmas is about miracles and divine intervention. I don't know how you feel about it, but I believe in miracles. I believe that God can perform miracles. God does perform miracles, and God will work a miracle in the lives of His children when nothing but a miracle will do. All of us ought to be excited to know that nothing is too hard for God. But there are a few things about miracles that we need to know before we run out thinking that God is like a genie in a lamp, and all we have to do is rub our Bibles three times and we get a miracle. Doesn't happen that way. Doesn't work that way. Let me tell you how a miracle works according to the Bible. The first thing we need to know is what a miracle is. Simply defined, a miracle is divine intervention. According to what we have read and what we know and believe about the Bible, a miracle is when God steps into a crisis situation on behalf of one or more of His children and suspends all laws and then imposes His divine will. A miracle is when God suspends natural laws, suspends laws of nature, suspends laws of gravity, suspends the laws of physics and the laws of science, and even the laws of biology, like He did in our text, in the case of the birth of His son. And then He imposes divine law. Then what we get is a miracle. A miracle is when Zacharias, the priest, you heard in this text, and his wife parented a child even though they were senior citizens. A miracle is Gabriel informing Mary that she's with child without benefit of male intervention. A miracle is that holy thing, as Gabriel calls it, inside of Mary being born the Son of God. A miracle is more than just an act of God. A miracle is when God steps in and the impossible moves out, like when Jesus was born. The second thing we need to know about miracles is that miracles are never promised and never guaranteed just because we're God's children or because we want one. No place in the Bible does God ever guarantee anyone a miracle. You read in Matthew chapter 17, verses 20 and 21, that if we have the faith of a grain of mustard seed, that we can move mountains. But then he says, that only comes with much prayer and fasting. But the Bible never guarantees a miracle just because we're God's children and just because we ask for one. Miracles are not promised. They're not earned, certainly not deserved. You can't work for a miracle. You can't buy a miracle. When a miracle does occur, it's always at God's discretion. It's always God's choice. And only when God decides, it's like grace. It's a gift from God and not of ourselves. Then there are components necessary if and when God decides to grant us a miracle. And you can check this list against the Bible. Miracles are only granted to those who have faith in God. And when there is a life-threatening or faith-threatening event, and all possible and available resources have been exhausted, allow me to repeat what I just said. In other words, God will only perform a miracle for people who believe in Him. We must have faith that God is, and God can, and is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him and believe in him. God does not discriminately or randomly issue miracles to heathens, infidels, or non-believers who don't believe in him. God does not waste miracles on those who won't give him the glory for performing the miracle. It's according to our faith. How many times in the Gospels do we hear Jesus saying, according to your faith, and then we see him performing a miracle? In Matthew chapter 8, we see him healing the centurion's servant without even being there. It was according to his faith. In Mark, we see him healing a man whose four friends let him down through a roof. I preached on that several months ago, to be healed by Jesus. The scripture said he saw their faith. Mark 7, we see him healing the Syrophoenician woman's daughter. He did it by her faith. Mark 4, he healed a woman with the issue of blood by her faith, that if she could only touch the hem of his garment, that she would be healed. And Jesus did it for them, and he can do it for us. But only if it's a life-threatening or faith-threatening, and we have faith in God. But then there is life-threatening or faith-threatening situations, like when the disciples were called out in the middle of a storm, in the middle of the sea, in the middle of the night. And their lives were at risk of being destroyed. They fought and struggled using every available resource that they had to battle the storm. And when all else failed, they called on Jesus. We qualify for a miracle only when we have faith and when everything we know to do has been done and everything we have at our disposal has been used up. Like when the multitude followed Jesus out in the wilderness, hunger set in because no one had any food to eat. The disciples took inventory. They found a little boy with a sack lunch of fishes and a few loaves who was willing to give it to Jesus. Faith plus need resulted in a miracle. God will take what looks like nothing, what really should not be enough. He multiplies it, then we get a miracle. And then they even had some left over. May I tell you that Jesus will never do for us what we can and should do for ourselves, even in the midst of our storms. But when provision runs out, Jesus will step in with his storehouse of supply. And when Jesus steps in, the impossible moves out. That is what a miracle is. A miracle is when God steps in. When God steps in and we give him the glory. It's not a miracle if we keep it to ourselves or give God's glory to somebody else. God must receive the glory because all glory is his. And when God steps in, the impossible moves out. There are times when nothing less than a miracle will do. It took a miracle when Moses and the children of Israel were at the Red Sea with Pharaoh in hot pursuit, mountains on both sides, and the Red Sea before them with nowhere to go. Moses stretched out his rod of faith and God stepped in. And when God stepped in and parted the Red Sea, danger moved out and the children walked across on dry land. It took a miracle when Gideon and his small fighting army of only 300 untrained soldiers of God doing battle against 32,000 seasoned Midianite foot soldiers. Then God stepped in, and when God stepped in, victory stepped in, and defeat stepped out, and Gideon won the battle. It took a miracle. When David came up against the Philistine giant Goliath, battling for the honor of God's name with only a slingshot, five smooth stones. And when God stepped in, Goliath went down and made David's enemies his footstool. It took a miracle when the three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, living in a strange land, they were told to bow down to Nebuchadnezzar's golden idol or be destroyed in a fiery furnace. They put their trust in God, refused to bow down, and that was when God stepped in. And when God showed up, the furnace suddenly got cool, and the boys were saved, and God got the glory. It took a miracle when Daniel was thrown in the lion's den because he refused to stop praying to his God for three times a day. Heaven got the news that Daniel was in trouble, and God stepped right in on time and locked the jaws of the lions all night long and kept Daniel from hurt, harm, and danger. Anything God has done once, he can do it again. And if he's done it for others, he can do it for us. So when it came to our salvation, one dark, dreary night in a little town called Bethlehem, God himself took personal responsibility, came down from heaven to be born of a virgin, save us from the penalty of sin. So when Mary asked Gabriel, "How can this thing be?" Gabriel declared an ultimate divine truth. Nothing is impossible with God.
Thank you.
Lord, we come to this table. We feel unworthy. We are only allowed to come because you died for us, died for our sins, Lord, that we might have a right to the tree of life. So we pray now for forgiveness of sins. We pray for this bread that represents your broken and bruised body. We pray for the fruit of the vine, which represents your shed blood. We also ask that you would bless every gift given by members of this church today, Lord, and every gesture, every act of kindness this year because of Christmas and because of COVID and other things. Bless us and keep us. In your name we pray. Amen. Church family. This is a great welcoming place to be. So as we leave this place today, we stay for our church meeting and commission us as brothers and sisters in Christ and share with you what a joy it is to stand in this place Sunday after Sunday. And I want to tell you that it is no small honor. When I think about Howard Marshall, I think about Randy J, I think about all the others who have, Jared and all the others, Don, it's just an honor to be here before you. So we leave from this place, we're going to offer a prayer for what you're about to do. You're about to make history. I just believe in my heart of hearts, as I always say, that best for you is yet to come. You just amazing. God is going to bless you and continue to bless you. Don't ever worry, because this is not ours. On this rock I'll build my church. It belongs to him, and he knows how to take care of his own. Father, we come now to pray for this congregation, brothers and sisters who sat where many have sat before. Some have gone on to be with you even this year, Lord, as we think about them, Jerry and Bruce and others, Miss Marley, Lord, and those that we hear about. So just continue your will be done concerning this church, this congregation, these wonderful people. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with God's people till we meet again. Amen. Danny Lynch, are you ready to come forward, sir? Whoever is going to stand with you.
Why do I feel like I've been here before? What began in February or March, somewhere along in there, has finally reached a possible conclusion today. The search committee, and I'm going to read off the names of the search committee. Greta Pryor was chairman, and I have to commend her. She was prepared, she was thoughtful, she was efficient, she had all the details covered. So I think she did an excellent job.
Amen.
Amen. Nina Abernathy, Regina Respis, Mickey Matthews, Nick Oliver, John Mundy, and David Pulliam. All of them did what I consider to be an excellent job in their considerations. And so we have arrived at a conclusion. A person that we are proposing be our next senior minister, and I will let Greta introduce him.
I concur with Danny that everyone on the committee did an excellent job, so thank you. So, as you all know by now, we've found a new senior minister. I hope that each of you have taken the opportunity to get to know Reverend Coontz using at least one of the options that was provided in the newsletter. I hate that we were not able to bring him in for a more formal introduction, but we wanted to keep everyone safe during this holiday season. Much of the information that I'm about to share may be old news for some of you, but I want to share what I shared with the board meeting a few weeks ago with all of you as well, and just in case you were not able to participate in one of the options. We had a handful of criteria that we looked for when reading the resumes. We wanted to make sure that our candidates were in a salary range that would fit our budget, individuals who were good administrators, and that could build relationships with all ages in our congregation. We asked questions about handling conflict resolution, church administration, handling an aging church that is in transition, and what our vision should be. Pastoral care was also very high on the list. We held a handful of interviews with various individuals, and we could never come to a 100% consensus, and that is until we met Reverend Nick Coons. His education is top-notch, his references were excellent, and he came to our initial Zoom interview so prepared that he basically answered all of our questions without having to ask. He is currently the senior minister at First Christian Church in Richlands, Virginia. He graduated early in both his undergraduate and graduate studies. He has a Bachelor of Arts in Biology and a Bachelor of Science in Evolutionary Anthropology from the University of New Mexico, Albuquerque, and has a Master's in Divinity from Bright Divinity School. If you took advantage of the get-to-know-you options, you found that he is a young man, but I assure you he is wise and mature beyond his age. He will be able to relate to both the young and the young at heart. As mentioned before, pastoral care was high on our list, and I don't believe he could have responded any better to our questions. He said it's a priority, something you drop everything for. In our first meeting, we discussed our desire for being a missional church and how he could help us get there. He is not a fan of attractional churches, and while he agrees we do not have to be attractional, we still need to be attractive. He chose to enter Search and Call because his current congregation is in a comfortable position, having grown quite a bit for the area they are located in. They are in a healthy place, both in size and age distribution. When he began, they had approximately 8 members in attendance each week. They have since grown to around 50, and that's even with a reduction in the town's population, which was about a third because they had back-to-back floods. He follows the lectionary, but also enjoys having sermon series. He uses scripture, life application, what little bit he probably has, and throws in a funny story when appropriate. We flew him into Fort Smith the first part of November, and after meeting with him in person, we confirmed again he is 100% our choice. It was unanimous. He is a deeply spiritual person, and he said something in our interview that will stick with me even after the search process is over, and that's prayer is the best, most spiritual thing we can do. There are 1,000 things we can mess up, but Jesus isn't one of them. Also, that he had given up on being president, so ministry was the next best thing. We met with the personnel committee, the board is voted, and this is now one of the last steps before we can welcome him as our new senior minister.
Questions? Answers? Without further objection, then I would move that we proceed to a voice vote. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Thank you very much. Nick Coons will be our new senior minister on January the 17th. Thank you.
Before we go, I want to extend a thank you to Reverend Ellis and Sabrina for being with us. I honestly don't know that we could have made it during this time of COVID without the two of you.
We get to have him at least for the next 6 weeks. Yes. Well, that's good. We are dismissed.
I just want to say, I plan to be here. I mean, it's not like y'all going to run me off. You know? And there are some things that only a senior minister can share with a young man. I'm not saying that, you know, to be rude or anything, but he's going to need some help. He's going to need your help, most of all. He's going to need prayer. But I'm going to be available, but not be in the way. Okay, so you look up some Sundays, Sabrina and I may decide to sleep in, you know. But for the most part, we'll be around here, okay? And what a joy it's been. Sabrina, you've not said much. You want to say anything? Okay. God bless you. God keep you. Stay in prayer. Stay in prayer. All right? You are dismissed. Thank you.